Thank you, Claire. Thank you for that very kind invitation. It's an absolute pleasure to be here today for several reasons. One, it's good to see old friends and colleagues back from our Tiger days. Two, as Claire mentioned, I got my PhD in pharmacology on this very campus. And number three, I have this list of goals, professional goals that I have. And then on that list, one of the goals is to be invited back by your PhD postdoctoral mentor to give a talk at her institute. So Claire, it's an absolute pleasure to be here today. I'm thrilled to be here today. We go back a long way, as you heard, and I've learned a lot from Claire. All right, so with that, let me go ahead and start with the start from here. If you access the SEER epidemiological database, you'll find that African-American men, indicated here by the red graph, have a higher incidence of prostate cancer compared to European-American men, compared to the Hispanic population here. And African-American men have a substantially higher incidence compared to individuals of Asian descent as well as Native Americans. Now, this higher incidence also extends to mortality. And so if you look on the left here, African-American men have a threefold higher mortality rate as it pertains to prostate cancer compared to European-American men. And on the right, even after adjustment for social determinants of health, we still have this 1.5-fold difference. And this remaining delta is believed to be due to the biologic or the genetic component of prostate cancer disparities. And so numerous labs, including my own, have leveraged genomic approaches in an effort to define this biologic component of prostate cancer disparities. And by interrogating African-American and European-American prostate cancer specimens, for the past 10 years or so, my group has been able to identify the following: differences in gene mutations, differential mRNA as well as microRNA expression profiles, as well, and differences in epigenetic events. Now, despite all of this accumulating evidence or data, from our perspective, there has been a limited number of actionable therapeutic leads to address cancer disparities. And so approximately 5 years ago, my lab decided to take a different approach. We decided to investigate RNA splicing in prostate cancer in order to address the following questions. So one, are there differences in RNA splicing in African-American cancer specimens compared to European-American specimens? Two, if there are differences, might that explain, at least in part, the biologic component of cancer disparities? And then finally, three, if there are differences in splicing, might that then lead to the identification of actionable therapeutic leads? All right, and so with that, let me just provide a brief overview or review of alternative RNA splicing. 90 to 95% of the 20,000 to 25,000 protein coding genes in the human genome undergo alternative RNA splicing. A given gene is estimated to give rise to 4 to 5 alternatively spliced RNA variants. These splice variants are regulated both temporally and spatially. Specific variants have been associated with developmental stages, cellular differentiation, disease predisposition, and something that has been of particular interest to my group is drug responsiveness. Now, interestingly, variants from a single gene can have completely opposite actions. And one of my favorite examples is the BCLX pre-mRNA, which can undergo splicing one of two ways. On the left side, we have skipping of exon 2B, leading to the formation of what's known as BCLXS. S is for the short variant. And this encodes a pro-apoptotic signaling protein. Now, the alternative splicing event on the right here, we have inclusion of exon 2B, and that leads to the so-called long variant, or the L variant, and that encodes an anti-apoptotic signaling protein. And so if we assume 4 to 5 alternatively spliced variants per gene, there's somewhere in the order of 100,000 to 125,000 different proteins in the human proteome. All right, and so with that, right here at the very top, this is a heat map that summarizes our interrogation of RNA splicing events in prostate cancer. And so the way you read this heat map, each row represents an individual patient, and each column represents a differential splicing event in a particular gene. And so the upper left-hand quadrant right here in red, this represents exons that have been included in the mature mRNAs that are expressed in European American samples. And the green quadrant at the left, lower left right here, this represents the same exons that have been excluded from the mature mRNAs that are expressed in African American samples. And the remaining two quadrants here represent the opposite scenario. And so this is a typical splicing event that we would observe in prostate cancer. So this is a hypothetical gene X with three exons. And so on the left here, in European American samples, we would have inclusion of exon 2, leading to the L variant or the long variant. And in African American samples, we would have exclusion or skipping of exon 2, leading to the formation of this S variant or short variant. And our overarching hypothesis is the following. For the mRNA variants that are expressed exclusively or preferentially in European American specimens, they encode less oncogenic signaling proteins. And then for the mRNAs that are expressed, or the variants that are expressed exclusively or preferentially in African American samples, they encode more oncogenic signaling proteins. Now, another interesting finding from our interrogation of the RNA splicing landscape, differential RNA splicing appears to be overrepresented in cancer signaling pathways. And this is one such example here. And everywhere we see this DS designation, that represents differential RNA splicing for that particular component when we compared African American samples with European American samples. And as you can see, for this particular signaling pathway, over half of the components undergo differential RNA splicing. And so we ended up focusing our attention on two signaling molecules. One of them, PI3 kinase delta. And this is work that was headed up by Badar Wong. And he was a former postdoc of mine, and he is now an assistant professor, tenure track assistant professor at the University of Maryland Eastern Shore. Now, the other signaling molecule that caught our attention was FGFR3, or fibroblast growth factor receptor 3. And that was work that was carried out by Jackie Olander, who just recently graduated from my lab. Now, we were particularly interested in FGFR3 because there's a small molecule inhibitor right here, davitinib, that has undergone phase 2 clinical trials in patients presenting with castration-resistant prostate cancer. And so we used davitinib as a tool to study the function of the different FGFR3 isoforms encoded by different mRNA variants. And so that's what I'm going to talk about right now and focus on. All right, and so here in panel A is the exon retention plot for FGFR3 that predicts the presence of an mRNA variant that retains all 18 exons expressed in European American samples. And that's indicated here by the blue plot here. For African American samples, there is a predicted mRNA variant that is missing exon 14, and that's represented by this red plot right here. And so here in panel B, we have a cartoon illustrating this differential splicing that is occurring for FGFR3. And so again, in European American samples, we have retention of exon 14, which we're referring to as the long variant or the L variant. And in African American samples, we have skipping of exon 14, leading to the formation of what we're referring to as the S or short variant. And so what Jackie did for this very top panel, she designed RT-PCR primers that would amplify exon 14 of the mature mRNA. And so she went back and sampled 50 patients, a separate cohort of patients from the original gene expression profiling that we did over here. And as you can see in the very top panel, she was able to, in the case of African American samples, we had weak amplification or no amplification of the long variant, whereas in European American samples, we had very strong amplification of the long variant. Now, when she designed RT-PCR primers flanking exon 14, as you can see for the second panel from the top, again, we have weak or no amplification of the long variant, and we have very prominent amplification of the short variant. And in European American samples, we have prominent amplification of the long variant, and then we have moderate to weak or no amplification of the short variant. And so we went back and analyzed RNA-seq data from prostate cancer samples and calculated the short to long expression ratio for FGFR3. And what we found was the following. for patients that had a low short to long expression ratio in their tumors, they had significantly greater survival compared to those patients that had a high short to long expression ratio. And so what we concluded from the survival analysis, that the short variant may be encoding a more oncogenic signaling protein that may, again, account in part for this cancer disparities. Now, when we analyze the RNA-seq data for other cancers, colon cancer on the left here and breast cancer on the right, and again calculated the short to long expression ratio. In this case, patients that had a low short to long expression ratio did not exhibit greater survival compared to those that had a high short to long expression ratio. And so at this point, or at that point, Jackie went back and she cloned the full-length cDNAs for both the long variant as well as the short variant. The long variant was cloned from a European American prostate cancer cell line. The short variant was cloned from an African American prostate cancer cell line. And as you can see from the partial alignment, the long variant does indeed have this 123 nucleotide segment corresponding to exon 14, which encodes a 41 amino acid domain here in red. And the short variant indeed is missing this 41 amino acid domain. And so one thing I want to stress here, the long variant, this has been cloned previously by other groups. It's the short variant that is novel, that's new. Prior to our work, it had not been described in the literature, nor was it described in GenBank or any of the genome browsers, such as Ensemble. And so for this 41 amino acid domain that's encoded by exon 14 of the long variant, that domain actually corresponds to what's known as the activation loop in orange here, which bifurcates the intracellular tyrosine kinase domain of the long isoform. And it's been shown in previous work by other investigators that autophosphorylation of these two adjacent tyrosine residues that then leads to the kinase switching from a less active state to a more activated state. And then subsequently, that tyrosine kinase domain will then phosphorylate other tyrosine residues on the intracellular domain of the long isoform. Now, interestingly, in lethal skeletal dysplasia, there is a lysine 650 to glutamate point mutation on the activation loop. And then that renders the tyrosine kinase domain constitutively activated in the absence of phosphorylation of these two residues here. And so with that information in hand, what Jackie then did was stably overexpressed the long variant and the short variant into two European American prostate cancer cell lines, LNCAP cells and PC3 cells here. And then she treated those cells with and without the agonist, receptor agonist, FGF2, and measured the phosphorylation status of the FGFR3 isoforms, as well as the phosphorylation status of the downstream signaling proteins, AKT and ribosomal S6, which I'll just simply refer to as S6 from now on. And this middle panel are representative Western blots using phospho-specific antibodies to look at the phosphorylation status of these signaling proteins. And what I want you to do is focus your attention on the far right-hand graphs. These are the summary plots. Open bars represent vehicle-treated cells. Closed bars represent FGF2-treated cells. And so for LNCAP cells overexpressing the long isoform when treated with FGF2, we observe this twofold increase in the autophosphorylation of the long isoform. That's associated with a twofold increase in the phosphorylation of the downstream signaling proteins, AKT, as well as S6. And we see very similar results with PC3 cells overexpressing the long isoform. Now look what happens in LNCAP cells overexpressing the short isoform. In the absence of agonist stimulation, we observe this 2.5-fold higher autophosphorylation of the short isoform compared to baseline autophosphorylation of the long isoform. And so what that indicates to us, the short isoform is constitutively activated. And with that constitutive activation, we have constitutive phosphorylation of AKT as well as S6. And when we treat these cells with FGF2, we do not observe a significant increase or further increase in the autophosphorylation of the short isoform, and we do not observe a further increase in the phosphorylation of AKT as well as S6. And we have similar results for PC3 cells overexpressing the long isoform. And then Now, we have similar effects in PC3 cells overexpressed in the short isoform. And so what we conclude from this series of experiments, the short isoform is constitutively activated due to this constitutive autophosphorylation. All right, and what Jackie then did was, again, looked at these same two cell lines overexpressing either the long or short isoform, and then treated these cells with and without davitinib, which is an inhibitor, and again, looked at the phosphorylation status of the FGFR3 isoforms, as well as AKT and S6. Now, one thing I want to point out here, davitinib has been shown previously to directly inhibit the tyrosine kinase domain of the long isoform. What we wanted to establish here was whether or not davitinib would inhibit the tyrosine kinase domain of the short isoform. And so again, I want you to focus your attention on the far right-hand summary plots. Open bars represent vehicle-treated cells, closed bars represent davitinib-treated cells, and with LNCAP cells overexpressing the long isoform, we have this twofold decrease in the autophosphorylation of the long isoform, and again, that's associated with a decrease in the phosphorylation of AKT and S6, and we have similar results in PC3 cells overexpressing the long isoform. Now, as I mentioned earlier in the previous slide, for LNCAP cells overexpressing the short isoform in the absence of agonist treatment, we have constitutive autophosphorylation of the short isoform, and again, that's associated with constitutive phosphorylation of AKT as well as S6. And when we treat these cells with davitinib, we do not observe a decrease in the autophosphorylation of the short isoform, and we do not observe a decrease in the phosphorylation of AKT and S6. And we have similar results in PC3 cells overexpressing the short isoform. And so what we conclude from this series of experiments, not only is the short isoform constitutively activated, but it is resistant to inhibition by davitinib. And so next, Jackie tested the ability of davitinib to inhibit proliferation in these cell lines. And so here in panel B, in the closed circles, we have PC3 cells overexpressing the long isoform, and we observe this dose-dependent decrease in proliferation with increasing concentrations of davitinib. By contrast, for PC3 cells overexpressing the short isoform represented by the open circles here, we have this rightward shift in the dose response curve indicating resistance. And this resistance is even more pronounced in LNCAP cells overexpressing the short isoform indicated or represented by the open squares in panel C. We also wanted to test the ability of the cytotoxic drug docetaxel to induce apoptosis in these cell lines. Docetaxel is a mitotic spindle poison commonly used in the treatment of prostate cancer. And so in panel B, for PC3 cells and LNCAP cells overexpressing the long isoform, we observe this dose-dependent increase by docetaxel to induce caspase activation, which is a surrogate measurement of apoptosis. Now in contrast, in the same cell lines overexpressing the short isoform, they are completely resistant to apoptosis by docetaxel. And so our in vitro findings that the S isoform is resistant to anti-cancer drugs also recapitulated in animal studies. And so here in panel A, the open squares represent PC3 cells overexpressing the long isoform that have been injected into the hind flank of nude mice, sub-Q, and these animals have been treated with daily saline oral vehicle, and after 30 days, we have robust xenograft or tumor growth, which is nearly or almost completely inhibited by daily oral davitinib treatment. Now, for the open circles, this represents PC3 cells overexpressing the short isoform, and as you can see, after injection into nude mice, after 30 days, we have very prominent tumor growth, and this is not inhibited by daily davitinib treatment. And so the obvious question, what is the mechanism of exon 14 skipping leading to the formation of the short variant? And there could be any number of possibilities. We could have, for example, mutations in the canonical splice acceptor and or splice donor sites in the pre-mRNA of FGFR3, Alternatively, the pre-mRNA may be harboring mutations in cis-acting binding sites for splicing factors. Another alternative, mutations in the splicing factor genes themselves. This is commonly seen in hematologic malignancies, such as lymphomas and leukemias, or we could have aberrant expression of the splicing factors themselves. And this, the last scenario is what we ended up investigating. And so when we went back to the Affymetrix exon array data, as well as the RNA-seq data, we identified 7 splicing factors whose mRNAs are significantly overexpressed in African-American samples compared to European-American samples. And this overexpression at the mRNA level, also seen at the protein level based on immunohistochemistry of patient specimens. And so as you can see from these representative results, these 7 splicing factors, they are more highly expressed in the African-American samples, indicated by the brown staining, compared to the European-American samples. And we also went back into the prostate cancer cell lines themselves. And so for the African-American-derived prostate cancer cell lines, RC77 and MDA, PCA cells, as you can see by immunocytochemistry, we have strong staining of these 7 splicing factors, indicated by the red pseudocolor, whereas in the European-American prostate cancer cell lines, we have moderate to weak expression of these same 7 splicing factors. And so what we then did was we went back and analyzed the flanking sequences of exon 14 for binding sites to these 7 splicing factors that are overexpressed in African-American samples. And more specifically, we analyzed exon 13, intron 13, 14, intron 14, 15, and exon 15. And what we found was an overrepresentation of binding sites to 2 of the 7 splicing factors, SRSF7, as well as HNRNPF. And so to further delineate the location of these splicing factor binding sites responsible for exon 14 skipping, we generated or constructed this mini gene construct. And so what we did was we took the open reading frame of enhanced GFP, split it in half, and then in between we inserted exon 14 and the flanking intronic sequences with binding sites to these 2 splicing factors. And we took the construct and then transfected it into prostate cancer cell lines. And the rationale being, if these intronic sequences are sufficient for exon 14 skipping, the 2 halves of the open reading frame for GFP should concatenate, leading to a functional protein, and we would be able to observe fluorescence. And so when we transfected this construct into European-American cell lines, such as LNCAP cells, as you can see, we did not observe fluorescence. However, when we transfected this construct into African-American prostate cancer cell lines, such as MDA-PCA cells, we had very prominent fluorescence. And so what that indicated to us that these 2 flanking intronic sequences with these binding sites were indeed sufficient for exon 14 skipping, but this skipping only occurred in the African-American cell lines that had high expression of these 2 splicing factors. And so the next step for us was to go ahead and knock down either one of these splicing factors to see if we could inhibit exon 14 skipping. And so what Jackie did was he took the same 2 cell lines here, MDA-PCA cells and RC77 cells. These are African-American-derived cell lines. And she first transfected these cell lines with a nonsense siRNA and performed RT-PCR. And as you can see in the first lane or first column, we have prominent amplification of the short variant, and we have weak to no amplification of the long variant. And this is exactly what we see in actual African-American prostate cancer specimens. Now, when she went back and transfected these cells with siRNA specifically targeting either SRSF2 or HNRNPF, we have this phenomenon that we've termed splice switching. We lose expression of the short variant, presumably because exon 14 is no longer skipping, and we gain expression of the long variant. And this phenomenon of splice switching has functional consequences. So for example, in panel A, with MDA-PCA cells that stably express empty vector, if we individually knock down SRSF2, indicated or represented by the dark bar here, or we knock down HNRNPF, represented by the light gray bar here, we see an increase in apoptosis compared to cells that have been transfected with the nonsense siRNA. And this apoptosis can be rescued when cells are transfected or when they stably express the short variant of FGFR3. When we then knock down either SRSF2 or HNRMPF, we no longer observe apoptosis. All right, and so here is our working model. In European American prostate cancer cells, there is low expression of these two splicing factors. And as a consequence, we have retention of exon 14 in the long variant that then encodes a long isoform that retains the activation loop. And as a consequence, we have minimal oncogenic signaling, and this long isoform is sensitive to davitinib inhibition. Now, in African-American prostate cancer cells, we have overexpression of SRSF2 and HNRNPF. What we don't know right now is the mechanism for this overexpression. We're trying to elucidate that now. But with the overexpression of these two splicing factors, we end up having exon 14 skipping, leading to the generation of the short variant, which then encodes a short isoform missing the activation loop. And as a consequence, this short isoform has constitutive autophosphorylation, leading to constitutive tyrosine kinase activity and enhanced oncogenic signaling and resistance to davitinib treatment. All right, and so what I want to do with the remaining time that I have left is describe some of our results related to differential splicing of PI3 kinase delta and the role it may be playing in African-American prostate cancer disparities, and also the role that this differential splicing may have in hematologic malignancies. And so here's the exon retention plot for PI3 kinase delta, which predicts the presence of a long variant that retains all 24 exons found in European-American specimens, and that's indicated by the blue plot here, whereas the African-American variant is predicted to be missing exon 10 and or exon 20, and that's represented by this red plot here. And so what Bedard did was generate or design RT-PCR primers flanking exon 20. And so in panel C, we have the representative RT-PCR validation results from a separate cohort of patients, again, 50 individuals. And as you can see for this very top panel, using those RT-PCR primers, we can amplify both a long variant as well as a short variant. However, in European American specimens, for the most part, we only see amplification of the long variant. And again, we went back to RNA-seq data to look at survival analysis. We went back and calculated the short to long expression ratio for PI3 kinase delta. And again, what we find, those patients that have a low S to L ratio in their tumors, they have significantly greater survival compared to those patients that have a high short to long expression ratio. And so again, we hypothesize that the short variant of PI3 kinase delta may be encoding a more oncogenic signaling protein, which is very analogous to our analysis of the short variant of FGFR3. All right, and so what Bedard did was he went back and cloned the full-length cDNAs for both the long variant from European-American prostate cancer specimens as well as the short variant from African-American prostate cancer specimens. And so for the long variant here, it does indeed have or retain all 24 exons, and it has a length of over 3,000 nucleotides. Now, when Bedard went back and cloned a short variant of PI3 kinase delta from African-American samples, we actually ended up cloning out several variants. So short variant number one here is missing exon 20. Short variant two is missing exon 10. Short variant three is missing both exons, and then short variant four is missing approximately 1,000 nucleotides. We believe that short variant four is actually a deletion gene mutation. And so we concentrate our efforts on short variant one, which is missing exon 20, and hence it's missing 56 amino acids within the catalytic kinase domain here. And we wanted to compare the short isoform with the long isoform that has an intact kinase domain. And again, from previous work from other labs, it's been shown that adalimumab directly inhibits the kinase domain of the long isoform. And again, we wanted to establish whether or not adalimumab inhibited the kinase domain of the short isoform that's missing these 56 amino acids. And so Bedar went back and he individually overexpressed the long and short variants in the two European American prostate cancer cell lines, VCAP cells and PC3 cells, and again measured the phosphorylation status of AKT as well as S6 in cells that were treated with and without the inhibitor adalimumab. And what you can see for the cells that were that overexpressed the long isoform, when treated with adalimumab, we have a decrease in the phosphorylation of AKT as well as S6. But in contrast, the same cell lines overexpressing the short isoform when treated with adalimumab, we do not observe a decrease in phosphorylation. Again, indicating to us that the short isoform of PI3 kinase delta is resistant to adalimumab. We also looked at the ability of adalimumab to inhibit proliferation in these cells. And as you can see, VCAP cells and PC3 cells overexpressing the long isoform represented by the open circles. We have this dose-dependent decrease in proliferation with increasing concentrations of adalimumab. And again, in contrast, for the cell lines overexpressing the short isoform indicated by the closed squares here, their proliferation is resistant to adalimumab. All right, and so these in vitro studies where the short isoform is resistant to adalimumab also seen in a mouse xenograft model. And so here in the open circles, this represents VCAP cells overexpressing the long isoform that had been injected into the hind flank of nude mice. And these animals were treated with IP injection of vehicle daily. And after 15 days, we see very robust xenograft growth, which is substantially inhibited by daily adalimumab treatment. Whereas PC3 cells overexpressing the short isoform indicated by the open circles when treated with daily vehicle saline, what we find after 15 days, again, is robust xenograft growth, which is not inhibited by daily adalimumab treatment. You can also take prostate cancer cell lines injected into the tail vein of nude mice, and those prostate cancer cells will metastasize to the lungs. And that's represented by the white coloration in these lung biopsies over here. And so when we inject animals with VCAP cells overexpressing the long isoform, we find that over half of the lungs are covered with metastases, and that can be inhibited by adalimumab daily treatment. Now, for VCAP cells overexpressing the short isoform when injected into the tail vein of nude mice, again, over half of the lungs, or nearly half of the lungs, are covered with metastases, which is not inhibited with adalimumab. And so again, we went back, analyzed the flanking sequences of the flanking intronic sequences of exon 20 for PI3 kinase delta, and we identified two binding sites for two splicing factors, SRSF7 as well as SRSF2. And when we go back and knock down those splicing factors in African American cell lines, such as MDA-PCA cells, and then perform RT-PCR, if you look at the two middle lanes right here, again, we observe this phenomenon of splice switching. We lose expression of the, or we decrease the expression of the short variant, and we gain expression of the long variant. And that's in contrast to cells that have been transfected with the nonsense siRNA. Now, within these two flanking intronic sequences, they do not have binding sites for HNR and PF. And so we use that as a negative control. And so when we knock down HNR and PF in this cell line here, we do not observe splice switching. We still have very prominent expression of the short variant, and we have low expression of the long variant. Now, just to remind you, when we do knock down this particular splicing factor, this does suppress, on the other hand, exon 14 skipping in FGFR3. All right, so adalimumab is not used clinically to treat prostate cancer patients, but it is FDA approved to treat certain B-cell malignancies. And so the obvious question to us was, is the short variant of PI3 kinase delta expressed in these B-cell malignancies? And so we went back to three cell lines, B-cell malignant lines. JECO cells, sub-B15 cells, as well as Raji, and by RT-PCR, as you can see, we have amplification of the short variant, and we're able to clone out the short variant in all three cell lines. And so why is this relevant? So it turns out that adelalisib therapy is linked to a high degree of primary resistance in B-cell malignancies. And so, for example, 30 to 40% of patients with CLL, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, have resistance to adelalisib. 40% of patients with follicular lymphoma are resistant to adelalisib. And 50 to 60% of patients with mantle cell lymphoma are resistant to adelalisib. Now, as of today, the mechanism of this resistance is unknown. We believe that the mechanism is due to this short variant. And so basically, we're going back now and we're asking the question, does the short variant of PI3 kinase delta correlate with primary resistance to adelalisib as well as other small molecule inhibitors of PI3 kinase delta? And so what we've done, and these are preliminary results, we are now screening 10 to 20 malignant B cell lines, and we're measuring their sensitivity to apoptosis as well as their sensitivity, their anti-proliferative sensitivity to adelalisib. And what we're finding for the cell lines that have, such as JVM2 and JECO, they are very resistant to adelalisib, whereas other cell lines, such as MINO, are very sensitive to adelalisib. And then we have cell lines that have intermediate sensitivity. And so what we've done is we've gone back to the results of these apoptosis and anti-proliferative assays, and we've generated what we refer to as a drug sensitivity score, or DSS. And that drug sensitivity score is inversely correlated with the short to long expression ratio of PI3 kinase delta in these cell lines. And so, for example, JECO cells and JVM2 cells that have a relatively high short to long expression ratio of 0.4 to 0.5, they have a low drug sensitivity score. In other words, they are resistant to adelalisib. Now, I'll just mention as a note, my graduate student, she originally came up with the term anti-cancer sensitivity score, but I told her that that would probably make for a very uncomfortable or awkward acronym, and so I ended up suggesting using drug sensitivity score instead. All right, so we are working with Jennifer Brown at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and she's supplying us with specimens from patients that have chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and we're going back and we're determining the short to long expression ratio in these patient specimens. And again, these are very preliminary, but what we're finding for the patients that are resistant to adelalisib, indicated by the red arrows right here, they tend to have a high short to long expression ratio, 0.4 to 0.5 or greater. Now, for the patients that are sensitive to adelalisib therapy, indicated here in green, they tend to have a low short to long expression ratio. So obviously, we need to screen hundreds of patients, and that's what we plan on doing. And we're hoping that if this short to long expression ratio holds true, that this may become a diagnostic or predictor of sensitivity to adelalisib. All right, and then finally, we've also generated, or we have this high throughput cell-free kinase assay system that we've developed to look at the activity of recombinant long isoform and recombinant short isoform. And what we're able to show, all of the clinically relevant PI3 kinase delta inhibitors that are used to treat the B cell malignancies, they are all able to inhibit the activity of recombinant long isoform. But as you can see, they are unable to inhibit the activity of the recombinant short isoform. And so what we're gonna do, we're gonna try to leverage this high throughput assay. We're gonna begin screening a chemical library of over 1,000 different compounds. We're hoping to find at least a handful of compounds that will inhibit the short isoform. And if we can find those compounds, we wanna then move them on to a preclinical mouse model of lymphoma. And if we can identify compounds that are successful in that model, then eventually we'd like to move that into the clinic. right? But that's sometime out in the future. All right, and so with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention. Here are the members in my lab. And also I'd like to thank many, many collaborators, including Claire Frazier, where this work would not have been done without their contributions. And so with that, I'd be happy to take any questions.